brand new van in your neighborhood.
That's right.
Yes. Sorry, the black teachers cannot do it because they have drawn themselves into a level of secrecy wherein they are woven into an interlocking relationship by playing a subordinate role to the groups like the Boule that we earlier talked about. With all of these things happening in the community, with more and more black people being educated and trained by the system of white supremacy here in America, things look as if we're really developing, when in actuality, things are getting worse with each kicking in. We cannot afford to continue to play around. We cannot afford to keep senselessly talking and talking and talking while the enemy is clear that they are fighting and fighting and fighting. This is a battle to the death. This is not a joke. This is not a game. These people mean to wipe you out. So what I suggest to you tonight, by having come here, that you support your brother, purchase the tape, listen to the lecture carefully, take back the information that you hear tonight into your community. Be willing to stand and promote those who fight for your best interest. I say to you that those who fight in your best interest are not going to be seen on the 6 o'clock news. Those that fight for your best interest will not be seen standing at the local campus university. Those who fight for your best interest will not be seen standing in the pulpit of the largest churches in the city. Those who claim that they work in your best behalf are not sitting downtown in City Hall. 99 times out of 100, those that are working in your best interest are right within arm's reach, and all you have to do is take the time to look at them. I think it's very appropriate that Brother Coakley comes to Baltimore tonight at this particular time to talk to you about the real, untold story behind the drug trade. And with all of the hullabaloo that has been raised on WOLG and WEAA and all of the other PHONEY radio stations, you will come to understand that if they were really serious about dealing with this issue, there's no reason why the place should not be packed tonight. But if you were to walk just a few short yards from here, you would see where everybody really is. It's sad to see that the CIA could not only dump dope into your neighborhood, and nobody could come up with an analysis no further than three little alphabets. It's sad to see that the CIA could in turn join forces with the private prison industrial complex and work to build multi-billion dollar prison industry to lock you away, and nobody does a damn thing about it. It's sad to see that nobody can go any further than the names of dead white men who have sold drugs to your community at such an accelerated pace that no one knows anything about it. Things are so bad that it's almost impossible to tell the difference between those who are sober and those who are strung out on crack. That's just how bad this thing has become. But when you look closely at the facts, you're going to start understanding that there's a process of development that is removing those who are serious about the liberation of black people. There is a move afloat to isolate and to neutralize them. And we have experienced that here in Baltimore at an unprecedented, a phenomenal rate of speed. And it has even destroyed the minds and the will of many people to fight. So, without any further delay, I suggest to you again that you check the brother's tape, get the information that you must come to understand. There is a tape on the table entitled The Drug Connect, $12 tape. Brothers and sisters, it's a very powerful analysis of those who you have been trying to decipher for years, trying to determine how the drug gets from Columbia to a central intelligence station, to your local neighborhood, into the veins and the hearts and the minds of your children, of your wives, of your husbands. This is a process of development that has been used to destroy us. And yet, the best analysis that you can get in the black community is that the CIA did it. So I suggest to you, Baltimore, that the story that started this whole fight, written by Gary Webb in the San Jose Mercury News in August the 18th, 19th, and 20th, 1996, was just a tip of the iceberg. And I suggest to you, as humbly as I can, that you sit up tonight and take notes. Because if you will allow Gary Webb, a white, hunky male, to tell you something that you should have known all along, if you will allow yourself to rely exclusively upon Gary Webb to tell you things that people have been fighting with for three decades, if Gary Webb is the best source of information that the black community has to offer, then the damn fight is over and we need to quietly go back to sleep. Now actually, drugs is not the gist of your problem. White supremacy is the gist of your problem. That's your problem, white supremacy. Anytime you have a black mayor that stands and advocates for legalization of Rockefeller's dope right in the city, and not a damn person says anything about it, then you know that's a bad state of affairs. Anytime a black man can take a $100,000 award for advocating it, and nobody says a damn thing about it, and even worse yet, all of the nigger preachers come forward and back this for it, then you know you ain't used to it. I can't say it any better than what I said. And I suggest to you tonight that you get yourselves a copy of this book, that you get yourselves a copy of the tape, check into the information, conduct your own research, educate black youth, because you're going to need it. And if you promote this zero tolerance nonsense without promoting zero tolerance on white supremacy, you're in deep trouble. So we announce tonight as a special holiday, zero tolerance on white supremacy. I say to you that you need to develop a sharper, firmer analysis of who it is and what it is that is exclusively fighting to reduce you to a state of nothingness. If you think that everything is going to be smoothed over and that everything will be okay, then remember these words spoken by Bill Clinton just a few short days ago. He said in very satanic code that we will not allow the forces of darkness to come against us. And he said, we shall overcome them. He was talking about you. He wasn't talking about no unseen forces. He was talking about you. And you can get out your voter registration cards and check and see whether you're Democrat or Republican, but it don't make a damn bit of difference. You're in deep trouble if you keep participating in the hunting system, believing that Whitey is going to deliver you. He does have a plan to deliver you. And his plan is designed to deliver you to the oven, the same way he did his hunky brother in 1932. So they say. So I suggest to you, Baltimore, that you get a little fighting, that you get a little hot, that you begin to understand that this thing is no joke. And I say this with no fear, that trouble is coming. And if it's coming in Baltimore, then it's coming in D.C. If it's coming in D.C., it's coming in New York. If it's coming in New York, then it's going to Atlanta. It's going to Florida. It's going anywhere in America where you might be. See, you got us running around talking about free South Africa, you do this, do that. South Africa got the same problem you got, white supremacy.
That's right.
We're running around talking about what we need to do as far as conducting better black-Jewish relations. The so-called UBI, what about you? We're running around trying to help the Koreans open up their stores and do better business in the black community while we don't have a damn thing. Name the largest black hamburger producer in America. Nobody knows it. Name the number one black army right here in America. Nobody knows it. Name the number one freedom fighter right here in America. Nobody knows it. Name the number one nigger preacher. Everybody could probably name it. And I say to you that I'm especially hard on preaching for a reason. Because those who claim that they are closest to the Most High have the audacity to stand and take money while lying to you at the same time. This thing has to be busted up. Did you know that if you do the right thing and present yourself to the Most High at the level and the manner in which you are to present yourself, He has given you the authority to go against those that have not had your best interest at heart? That's in that book that they call the Bible. I just don't know why nobody has ever gone in there and dug it out. This thing didn't do, brothers and sisters. Somebody has lied to us. I remember reading a passage in the Bible that talked about a time coming when a certain group of people would rob those who had robbed them, and that they would spoil those who had spoiled them. And that it also goes further to advocate that you prepare slaughter for his children, so that his children would rise no more to fill the face of the world with their feet. I only know one group of people that's filling the face of the world with their feet while wiping you out all at the same time. If you think that this drug game is a joke, stick around in just a few short weeks, just a few short days, a few months. You will find that the city is going to legalize dope. They're going to run over you with this madness. And the way this thing is going to end up, before you know anything, you're going to look up and everybody will be running their right here in the CBS, getting their dope, all with the sanction of a so-called brother who told you that he had your best interest at heart while taking a secret oath, pledging his loyalty to Humpty David Rockefeller. Nobody ever talks about this. You can't get this across the airwaves at WOLB, which is telling each and every one of you that as long as you relax, you will be below civilization. They're going to put you below the dirt. That's the way this thing is set. So I say to you, in all sincerity, get your brother and sister together, because the battle has begun. The only problem is this time, nobody heard the shots. The shots were fired long ago. But in the meantime, we were fighting to get a bigger Cadillac. Fighting to get up in that new condominium next to some white boy. As Miss Fanny walked by with her short skirt on, we were fighting to be just like OJ. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, that if you keep chasing white girls, whether she be in a skirt or a little vial, the sky's that crack, she's going to die by throwing this foolishness. So I suggest that tonight, each of you bears the burden of officially telling somebody else that they missed a hell of a presentation tonight. And there is no excuse as to why we shouldn't have this place filled to capacity. Sadly enough, I've got to throw this in for the record, and I'm willing to bet you that if you go downstairs and look around, there are probably more of us downstairs than there are upstairs. Now, I know there might offend some of you, and I know that may hurt, but this is just an acknowledgement of the fact. You live in a city, I'm sorry, in a country, with 1.6 million people behind bars. And according to my last statistics and research, 83% of that 1.6 million was black men and women. It costs between $30,000 to $50,000 per year to feed, clothe, and house a prison inmate. But yet, that same amount of money could be used to buy tracts of land, to plant vegetation, to produce the food that you and I need. The number one thing, that's why we feel the earth, we're not making any more. And as we constantly lose touch with the earth, they have us looking up, thinking we're going to heaven, to get our pie in the sky, while he's digging dirt all around us, laying graves and foundations. Don't climb around with it. Don't sleep on it. Keep your eyes open. Do yourself a favor. This time around, when the polls are open and it's time to vote, I suggest you show up. And you know what I suggest you do? Show up with your shotgun. Shut the polls down. There is no way possible that you can believe in American democracy democracy has always been a fraud. Democracy means human rule. Remember that. Why would you vote for the devil when the devil is not going to deliver you? Brothers and sisters, I suggest you make a conclusion. Again, Brother Coakley is in town tonight. Support your brother. Grab the information. Take those tapes back. Turn those stereos down in your car. You want to blast something in your stereo? Blast those Coakley tapes. I remember in the summer of 95, I had a pickup truck with a single loud stereo system. And I would ride through the city and blast some of those tapes. And I remember playing the protocol and learned all the design. I remember getting pulled over downtown at St. Paul's for blasting the protocol. And I got a citation just for having my music too loud. And at peace, Brother Coakley was declared as music too loud. That's the kind of music you want to pump in the community. You want to pump the music? Pump that Coakley music. Pump that tape. Pump this Brother Wolf tape. Pump the bass theory on the music. Those are the things that you need to begin to understand. Check the table. Do yourself a world of wealth by grabbing the right information. Put that Colt 45 down long enough to pick up a 90-minute tape. Sit still. Don't worry about getting to the club, kicking your ass tonight. Pop that tape in. This is what it requires. See, liberation isn't something that's going to be handed to you by way of a headache. Liberation is not something that's going to be handed to you by way of the federal government. They're not going to legislate your liberation, but they will legislate your ass right out of existence. Don't you get caught sleeping in the humble thinking that they won't do it. Don't you get caught. I say to you that tonight is a special night in Baltimore. And it's very special simply because you have a brother that has spent an enormous amount of time researching, digging, trying, going to the enemy, getting you the enemy's names, the enemy's faces, the enemy's addresses, the enemy's profile, the enemy's program. And you know what? Most of the people will say, yeah, I know that cookie stuff. I've heard it 100 times over. But the question actually becomes, what have you done to overcome what is overcoming you? So without further delay, I'm going to shut up. Because I call it quits. And at this time, we bring forth the most profound researcher that the black community has yet to know. One of the most profound freedom fighters that this century has ever known. And tonight, we vote as Freedom Fighter of the Millennium. I bring to you Brother Steve Coakley. Give him a wonderful round of applause. You all coming out to the, where we at, sister? Where we at?
Baltimore.
And, oh yeah, that's right, Earth, Baltimore, America, what's the name of the place? Because this going around the country, you want to know where the place at, they gonna come up in here.
Woodstock
Lounge. Woodstock Lounge, right. They got lottery, keno, beer, alcohol, wine. Downstairs, do I even say it? We probably said, man, everybody gonna come out in the rain. He said, yeah, look downstairs. They out, Bob. They out. Wait, tap downstairs now. Nah. We just ain't offering the right stuff. Whatever it is, to think what it is more important than facing. And that's all right, because people are trying to call until they believe the time is right. Now, pretty sure we're looking at the vagueness even of the Million Man March and how many people showed up that. If the time was right, everybody make a move. I saw many of the brothers who love wine and liquor, who were out at the mall, who were skinny, drinking and holding each other up and say, just hold on, man, March almost over, man, we'll get over there, but just get a few minutes. And they want to stand there with the rest of the men. So potentially we know that they will be key soldiers in a war. They will be, and they already, many of them are ahead of their time. Some of the most fascinating moments I've had in organizing have come up out of people who appeared to be less than what they really were. And many times our people in disguise just really holding out. Maybe a month from now that's me, having tried this and tried that and done this and done that, stuff like it didn't work.
and start looking for some alternative motion to make me think that maybe nothing's wrong with me. Because sometimes when black people don't do what they should do, and in the face of what's wrong, we really look and say, well, damn, maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm paranoid. I'm getting into it a little too tough. Maybe we should lighten up and learn how to cooperate and shit. Cooperate. And so those questions we have to deal with. And I think, everybody really want to hear no bullshit about no CIA and no white people. And as my man Carter said, man, you should hear him out telling him, man, make sure you don't go to that coffee lecture, man. You cannot give credibility or certification to that bullshit. You cannot do that. And the reason you can't do that is that if a base theory on evil gets established, and when they go up under the covers and they see our name, then where will we stand with the people? So, that it might even be a right analysis, but the analysis will ruin our reputation if they gonna come this way. So you don't never want no all or nothing operation in a community struggle, because people ain't struggling for community, they struggling for stability. Personal, financial stability. And when their personal things are right, the other things can be left. I don't like doing things with people who have jobs. Because when they do this, they don't do it well because their jobs interfere with it. There's a process elector, base theory on evil. We're going to jam on that tonight. The one that comes after base theory on evil is the oath taker. Now they develop an offshot of the oath taker called the law abider. The law abiders, brother. These are my hunters that pay the bills on time, stop at the traffic lights. They do everything when the police say stop, parole it for right on. When they say get out of here, right now. They're the law abiders. They're not in the Masonic Society. They're not in the Boule. They're not in the Rosicrucian. But they abide by any obstacle in their face, they abide. They go along. Okie dokie. And so they're a bigger threat to our liberation as the oath takers are, who are, as C. Miles called them, sucker perpetrators. Now, even when a person admits that the conversation is all right, now I know Brother Donald, I'll play a little clip of Brother Donald set C. Miles up by asking him about the Boule. But he don't say Boule, he just say some individual people. And he agrees to all them, my son was with him, and I love him, and we know them. And then he said they Boule, he say, oh, no, we'll be bringing no third world conspiracies up in here. You know, you gotta repudiate what you just said to my frat brother. Said, well, you know what about that Coakley? Oh, no, we don't have no Coakley shit in here. I knew the brother's name was Rouse. He's down in Atlanta. And he was the Armstrong Williams of Atlanta.
Ooh.
On the white station. So that the blacks on the black stations didn't like him. And so when they asked me that I want to go on his show, and I heard his show, I said, no, I wouldn't be on Armstrong Williams' show, and I wouldn't be on Rouse's show. Mm-hmm. So when I get up here and see he's under the name of Steve Miles, I said, that's nigga Rouse. I said, yeah, I bet that nigga name. Well, I'll they call in there. I said, what's your name? He said, yeah, Ralph, that was my name. In Atlanta, Ralph, that's right. The people didn't believe me. I remember they were closing their faces down and shit. And they called him and said, man, come help me. I said, I don't help him. I wouldn't even go on the show. And, you know, the brother do some good things, but then he do that other thing, too. And I tell you, whenever they come out like fourth time, you get... You don't know what to do, that's the enemy. Jesse Jackson 1 week be out against Obama. Then he knocked the CIA story off the front page. Then 2 weeks later, he's for Obama. Right, well you know man, I've seen what's one of the sickest things, and I need to comment on this. I'm on my paper head. I got to go back and do the open and over. I mean, you don't even get started and get knocked. I'm about to tell you that. I want to make sure I don't miss it, brother. Don't want to miss this. All right, this is Steve Coakley live in Baltimore. We'll be soon by way of Cincinnati. We got our own radio network. We're here laying the premise for the base theory on evil and then on into the CIA's involvement in the drug trade, the untold story. And we're now discussing the past and the present and sucker perpetrators. But that's a little inside joke for here in Baltimore, but we're here clarifying some issues, and one of the things I was trying to make clear to the audience was about some of the things that we've heard on the radio and some of the activities of the brothers and sisters in terms of getting to the bottom of something. And over the course of the past, many times our style of doing things has been greatly underestimated. We're at odds with some members of our own community about the intensity and the penetration of white supremacy. Many people want to fight but don't want to fight all the way. Many people want to engage but do not engage to win. Many people, if asked in our community, who are in the struggle, have never thought out an endgame. They have no preferred world. They have no scenario that they can walk themselves through to even show that they can see African liberation. For many don't believe, really, that we could do it. But in fact, we will, we can, we must. It is a mere backdraft to the fact that the ones that have it have failed, and they are doomed to self-destruction. So tonight, we're going to talk a little bit about the CIA. Now I'll come back to the little personal smut stuff. We're going to talk about the CIA. This is the CIA logo, which is called a radiant rose. And I know some of my friends are deep in the Rosicrucian. And it says it's a 16-ray rose. And very intriguing as a logo. And that the bald eagle facing a certain direction. These are books I got at the Black Caucus. They were handing them out at the booth when Maxine Waters was up there with 2,000 people against the CIA. The CIA was downstairs in the exhibition hall, passing out brochures and shit. You know that double wing type of thinking. You know, you see, on one hand you're against it, but on the other hand you provide access to it. So it reminds me of the question that the one brother asked that you all formed with Tyrone Powers. He said, "Brother, now I heard a case you did down in North Carolina, down in Norfolk, and did you say on the case that brothers should join the FBI?" And he said, "Well, I didn't really say that, you know, but the question was whether a good man should join the FBI. And if it is as bad as what he say it is, and it is worse." And of course, he knew it. He couldn't turn it around, which he admitted he tried to, honestly. Say that three, that would be no place for a good black man. And we wouldn't want to give that cross references. And I need to tell you, I announced it Tuesday night in my lecture in Washington that we'll be having a forum April 11th. April 11th, that weekend in there. And it'll be Intelligence Weekend. And Tyrone Power, Steve Coakley, and some more people gonna get together here with reality speaks and some more people, and we're gonna have a cookout. We're gonna have the cookout. That's how we're gonna get the brother David. That's how we're gonna get the white supremacy free zone. We're gonna cook it out. So you're right, we're gonna cook it out. Burn it at the stake. Get the tires and shit. Have a rubber tire award. And again, don't you underestimate what it means to send a flank up against the buffer for the enemy, because it was that flank of the PAC that went up against the buffer of the enemy that made the white man go get Mandela out of the bullpen and made him head of government.
Right.
It was not attack on whites. Go check the story. Whites were, the layer of whites didn't even get the attack yet. They seen they blacks go down and count it. Well, you know, they threw the 18th layer. Now we're the 20th layer. He said, well, look, what was Mandela in jail for? How long? And how long was he supposed to stay there?
Right.
How did he get out? What did they do, drop all charges against everybody during that period? How did he get out? You ever seen him drop the charges?
No.
You never saw no sheriff. You ever saw no real announcement saying the charges of conspiracy to overthrow the government?
Right.
Were ever dropped?
No.
Okay, I just want you to remember that shit, son. I want you to think about who's in jail you'd like to see out and what trouble you can cause that will make the white man get them out as the last leg to take that ass kicking. But the ass kicking he's going to get now, there's a bunch of real pontificators that are going to assure us that that don't happen. I'm going to tell you something. Y'all in Baltimore, name me the baddest, toughest black organization in Baltimore.
Hey,
you know what? We're chasing brother up there. Yeah, we just been going 18 months. We've been going to Baltimore for this since 70 something. To be exact. So the point is, something is wrong when we go in these cities. See, I noticed something. The cities that have the most talk radio have the least black power. I want you to walk around the country and count who got New York all day, all night, black power outside of Charleston. Who can? Charleston is a shrewd brother. He play all sides of every issue. I know him personally. He's played all sides of every issue with me. But if you can out-research him, you can force him to ride the route for you. But you gotta force him. You gotta put up the barricades to make him run only one way. So if he go on, he'll be with you and be with them. Preachers know how to do that. They know how to do that. They be with God and the devil. Right? Promise you God will scare you with the devil. No, really. And so that double nature allows people to operate when they consider effectively. So we got a town with a lot of talk radio. And talk radio tends to diffuse the power of people. Why? It could be a monster. It could be a monster. It could be a monster. You can stick talk radio on people and jack some shit up. Like people smell a little something on that Korean store. Smell a little victory. We got the Koreans. Now, I talk about people. I want you to lay out a power analysis of the Baltimore-Washington corridor. And now I want you to rank the Koreans. In the Baltimore-Washington corridor, dude, are they bigger than Congress? Are they stronger than the Senate? Are they stronger than the Defense Department? And how about that Jewish man with the black lady at the Defense? Oh, y'all ain't caught that, huh? William Cohen, yeah. The Secretary of Defense, Trilateral Commissioner, got his black wife there, Janet Langhart.
Ooh!
Do you see that? Honey, you did a good job at swearing in. You was rubbing him and shit. Quit with him, man. You just tell him to quit hugging on him and shit at the swearing in, which was earlier today. Yeah, man.
The one that be on TV?
Well, yeah. No, not the one on the NBC on the weekend, but this Janet Langhart is on the Black Voices saying something. That's Wilbur Cohen's wife.
Yeah.
So now you got Sister Man laying low with that candy fence. So for the sake of posterity, let's just call her Sunshine. Who was Sunshine? Sunshine was the sister in Harlem Heights who took all the little boy to bed to help the brother make a move.
Yes?
All right. Pull that under your nose. All right? And you gotta watch him. You gotta watch the dynamic between the two, because he's deeply the aggressor. But that's another story. And yeah, man, I'm a corn for president. All right. Anyway. So that's interesting too, where he's gonna stand on the CIA drug issue, because once they get through fucking with CIA, they gotta know it's the Defense Department. The Army, when they were moving drugs out of Mena, Arkansas, and they moved them on the big barges, like, if we were to go down to the harbor up here in Baltimore, we could catch us some drug sellers, you know?
Yeah.
Why don't the radio stations and everybody lead you down to the harbor, let's write down the numbers of all the ships we've seen, and let's hunt down the ships that don't have no numbers, because some of them ain't got no numbers. Yeah, because if you start counting the numbers, if you start pulling the names, all of a sudden, they ain't going to add up. That's another story, but the Army Corps of Engineers, the people who ran the drugs in Mena, Arkansas, said when they were running the drugs up the barges to be met by the trailer truck, he picked it up out the truck, off the barges, and put it on the truck, while the helicopters and the small aircraft followed the truck to make sure the truck brought the drugs. You talk about $40 million worth of drugs. They got a plane over the truck to make sure the truck hit their face. And the plane watches the exchange between the barge and the trailer truck. Because these are people paying people to dump the stuff up. But They say when the barge comes, it's the Army Corps of Engineers that get it through the dust to do the barges. So we talking about the Army having to help the CIA, even though they ain't got the Army in the story. That's another story of stuff. Anyway, I'm not gonna bore you all with this old poopy nonsense all night. Because I know ain't nobody got no time for this. All long, I don't care about it. So we got some good information to share on that, what's on that popcorn topic. We got some good information to share on those things, and we're going to be real sharp about offering something different. I did need a television VCR tonight, and in that process, I was going to show you some testimony from people who had been involved in drug activity, and they were giving testimony of their involvement. For example, there's a white guy named Terry Reed. He wrote this book. In fact, they asked the WOL people to see if they could get him on the show. And so far, I haven't heard anything about him. Maybe I know I don't hear all the shows, so I know there are things I couldn't see or could have missed. But he wrote this book entitled Compromise. And let's just imagine, I don't have my gavel with me, but let's just imagine that we're in a grand jury, and you all are a grand jury. Anybody ever been to grand juries before? I've been to a grand jury before. Y'all, anybody been to grand jury before? Anybody seen? Now, I ain't nothing scary about going to grand jury, but usually it's a group of old couples or some white people who sitting at this long 2-3 row area, and they're sitting in judgment based upon a prosecutor talking to them directly. You can't have no attorney in there with you and no other side. It's just the government privately presenting evidence to a group of people who are getting paid to hang around the court and hear shit. Usually they're old, grumpy white people, and the prosecutors love the grand juries because they're such a fertile ground for any type of allegation. It's like calling the grand jury on the sister at the Garvey School.
Right.
The trump up of support the right of a white person to walk in a closed environment at any time they choose to, and jack up an educator any time they want to. In fact, I was even reading the paper. They just did a story on Marion Barry in the city paper, and the lady who wrote the story said, well, when I walked into his office, he didn't stand up to greet me. Jonah something Barrett, who writes all that DC stuff and always puts a negative black person on the cover and dogs them out. I don't know how often you all see the city paper that runs out of Washington, but it's a dangerous thing. So let's just imagine we're the grand jury and I'm offering up evidence. I want to lay before you, now we're prosecuting the other side. A couple of things I want to ask you about the CIA drug story before I jump into the base series. This story got going recently because of what newspaper?
Mercury News.
And what city is it in? And what color was the man who wrote the story?
White.
Now, how did that white man get the story? Who did he go see to get the story? Who'd you say, sister? No, it wasn't. No, he went to black people. He went to Ricky Ross. He went to other black people. He went to black people to get the story, right? What's the story? Good story? The story had a big impact, didn't it? So he writes this story, has big impact. He gets it from black people, then black people get the story.
Right.
What do they do with it?
Blow it up.
Blow it up and take it to who?
The white man.
Yeah. I'm confused. A white guy does a story from some black people. The black people get the story and take it to the white man and ask him, what's up?
Do you know what's up?
He didn't bring it up.
Right.
Now I've got to make some judgment as to whether that's a legitimate strategy to stop. First, you want to stop CIA drug activity. I mean, to know about it is one thing, but you want to stop it.
Correct.
And then you want to indict, charge, hunt down those who were involved in it.
Correct.
Then you want to assess it. See, way out there get that tone. The CIA said, okay, yeah, we did it. All right, we'll pay whoever was damaged by crack. We want all crack users to line up. Line up, we'll pay. Yeah, Mama was looking at all the people who stand themselves up and indict themselves.
Right.
To sign up for a judgment of what they wouldn't even know what might be $30. You know? But what? I bet you They got gun giveaways and all that. Don't think it's so illogical they're going to line up. In fact, before you know it, they'll be trying to legalize drugs, which will make the whole story moot. Mm-hmm. Oh, we have lost more. I'm sorry. Right. It wouldn't be no story if everything was legal, right? CIA be off the hook, right? Probably take a mayor of CIA to do something like that.
Okay.
Gold Scholar mayor of CIA. Yeah, you do know Smoke work with the CIA, don't you? No, you do know CIA works in every municipality, and the way they work through the municipalities with the mayor, don't you? You do know that, don't you? You do know working for a mayor. If you ever get close to working for a mayor, you know every agency in the world works through a mayor. Every diplomat in one form or another operate in a city. Every crisis has somebody at the bottom of it who must deal with that mayor of all nationalities and all countries. You do know that, right? So you do know the mayor deal with the CIA, work with the CIA, right? In fact, if you were to go to the Rumor Control Network or the Human Relations Commission right here in Baltimore, you'll see the CIA right there.
Mm.
Right there, they work right there. Mm. You don't think this town's so lame and tame without the help of the CIA? I mean, you know, the CIA would be threatening the states off. Anyway, there ain't no excuse here. Raising the dead. Anyway. So, y'all get in these spots where I get mad, and then I know that I don't want to get to the whole card before it's right. But let's raise another question. Okay, what is the relationship between FEMA and the CIA? No relationship, some relationship, don't know. Would have to get indicators or forecasters to tell them when we were in, quote, a state of emergency. So there must be some relationship between the one who picks up all intelligence, the CIA, and FEMA, who answers to intelligence with executive action or martial law. Y'all heard martial law? Okay. So is there a relationship between FEMA and the CIA? Possibly, don't know.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, see the danger of a little information? Now let's just say you were FEMA, and this is now April, May, and June. You know the boy coming with the story in office. You got CIA all over his web top, right? You got CIA all over where he's going around asking these questions, right? So you know the story coming. You know they're winding it down. So you looked up and say, well, damn, where the story say? South Central, let's go to South Central and see if we can do something to lessen the impact. So what the fuck was in FEMA in there? So FEMA goes into South Central and gives the largest grant it ever gave in the history of FEMA to a black neighborhood. In fact, FEMA don't give shit to a black neighborhood for any reason whatsoever. But they give up $3,560,000 to what? To build the rebuild the Watts Community Center, which was destroyed in the rebellion surrounding Rodney, what's his name?
King.
All right? FEMA. Related to CIA, executive branch. What president created FEMA?
Carter.
Who was the man who wrote up the spec for FEMA? During the Carter administration. There we go. We got to cut a light. Is that too bright? That's too bright.
Too bright.
Would that cut down, Chris?
All right.
Okay. Now FEMA gives up a $3,500,000 grant, $560,000. Right? Now I'm in that way when they give up this money, and I look up, they have an African American Unity Day in what? Mm. Y'all ever heard of Danny Bakewell?
Yeah.
Danny Bakewell, Operation Brotherhood in L.A. operation. You can very good demonstrate real strong and get black jobs at construction sites and stuff. So you want to support them. And you got big Operation Brotherhood dinner and stuff, you know.
Looks like a white guy.
Yeah, got silver gray hair, light skin. Danny Bakewell, good brother, basically. Maxine Waters and all the local elected officials had African American Unity Day, where they had a big 6-foot check. Y'all see them big checks they have?
Yeah.
When they giving you some shit, they white people blow the money up and shit,
yeah.
Right? But this big check, they all held, they stood around the check. It was African American Unity Day. The black community of Washington, FEMA. African American Unity Day, as FEMA gives this $3,500,000 check to Watts. This is in April. May, June, July, August, Payal, Mercury story. September Black Caucus, Maxine Waters comes to the forefront on the issue. All right? Now you gotta ask, and you gotta ask her, what did it take for FEMA to decide that it would give you the largest direct grant they ever gave to any black community in its history? And the Watts Community Center, is it their plan in incarceration to in fact use the building that they will build to detain those people in the neighborhood which you claim to be serving? Because if the story is effective and the blacks go off, where they gonna put them? In the center that FEMA just got her to build for them. Probably just nothing. Probably just nothing. Deutsch goes all the way out there, unprecedented. John Deutsch, Trilateral Commissioner, CIA Director, goes to the black community, and first time you ever seen a CIA go anywhere in the black community respond to anything ever. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Then you see little white people, all those communists, jump up out there and start talking all the way, little communist stuff, and messing with each other. Anyway, that's a whole nother story. Anyway, but FEMA, CIA, FBI, military intelligence are all what we call guardian animals. The CIA is a guardian animal. Now, CIA, what is CIA? Central Intelligence Agency. What year it started in? So that means that America really been messing with people much longer than 47. So the CIA is a part of a trend of intelligence adaptations necessary to control a population. Period. Central intelligence alleges not to be domestic, which is nonsense. It's impossible. And intelligence agencies don't like other intelligence agencies, so they ain't so easy to be sharing with each other. Now this book here is one of the better books on the CIA, called CIA and the Cause of Intelligence. Victor Marchetti and John Marks. You got this over there, brother?
No, I have a house.
You got it at the house, all right. CIA and the Cause of Intelligence. Now, these are two men who worked in the CIA. It's one of the first books ever censored. It's got parts where they deleted. It's very interesting to guess what were in the deleted parts. But what is important is, who is the principal constituency of the CIA? Meaning that the men who work in the CIA, little white boys out of John Hopkins, up here in Baltimore, little white boys out of Georgetown, down there in Washington, little white boys out of Harvard and Yale and University of Michigan, the little white boys out of University of North Carolina, etc. These little white boys are going into the CIA because their mamas and daddies don't have enough millions for them not to work anywhere but on the family investment. So they choose a career. Some of them become career foreign service, but you must recognize them as not owners of the society, just regular average, below average, or slightly above average whites who are going to work a job.
Right.
You on that?
Yes.
So as a guy just working a job, he decides when the word go out, say, hey, we're going to kill Castro. They don't sit up and say, why are we going to kill Castro? They devise a plan, they devise a day, they devise strategies, they identify personnel to accomplish what someone else is society to have guns. That is true. So when we get into the CIA moving drugs, we understand that the CIA doesn't move drugs for a conclusion that they derive, for they're not conclusion derivers. You understand their role? They are only an operator who operate on behalf of someone who owns something, who is the ultimate face or, hey, get somebody down there and crush that kid. So you're right. Something coming down from on high. So when we say CIA, even if we went and took over headquarters, all we would find is teletype to the CIA telling them tomorrow we want this shit done. And then we're going to say, oh, all this time, all these troops we lost taking this building, and there's still a sucker perpetrator out there somewhere. No, this was, and then we say, damn, that's heavy now, because now you've got to decide, if you start beating another man's headquarters, what do the antennas do that take instructions? Well, maybe some of them might band together to form a squad of their own to fight for themselves until we defeat them. They break away from the larger surrender. All right, this revolution talk, all right? Thank you, everybody. So now, I was like, hey, maybe we might go around 68th Street in New York to hip up around the headquarters of the Council on Foreign Relations. Maybe we might find a file in there that says that we are the remnants of a secret society that's for Anglo-Saxon Zionist rule throughout the world. Point number one. And as such, we have created a government. We have created a lifestyle. We have created a sport. We've created education. We've created law. We've created government, Congress, Senate, state, county, local, aldermen, to assist us in our goal. Now, our goal is never to be broken. Upon our goal, we take a sacred oath that we together forever against all people of color. Why? Because we know, white thinking, that we are heathen. Something wrong with us. Now you all heard the white guy on WL last week. He's telling them about the Moon Project and Kennedy. Interesting stuff, right, David? Too bad they put a hunky on this week, which tried to contradict everything that the guy said last week. Linda Mitchell did one of these does. She had a guy on telling the truth, brought another white guy on who was a white supremacist, no caveman, who did not want to, though he used the Bible, don't want to say it's black. I mean, I always say now, we don't get no religious conclusion because fact has no role in religion. So whatever these kids, whenever you hear a religious argument, you address it by saying, before I get in this, what role will fact play in our discussion? And if we end up having to admit that it's faith and belief, then we will relegate it a station called possible. But that's not affirmative enough to accomplish what we need in the forefront of what we're doing. So don't get caught behind a religious zealot activist. They'll ruin the whole damn thing, trying to be one better than just another. And of course, we'll know them by what they do, not by what they claim they are. We ain't gonna get in no more, hey, look, you know, everybody that say it is police ain't. Okay. Well, now, figure out that in the midst of this discussion on the CIA, I ain't still heard nobody mention nobody's name but the CIA.
Right.
But we always say we go to Coakley 101. Coakley 101 says that the principal constituency of the CIA is the CFR. And we know that by this stage in the CIA Court of Intelligence. And it's very profound. Page 237. It says, for the influential but private council composed of several hundred of the country's top political, military, business, and academic leaders has long been the CIA's principal constituency, in quotation marks, in the American public. When the agency has needed prominent citizens to front for its proprietary company or for other special assistance, it is turned council member. Has long been the CIA's principal constituency.
So what role, if the CFR is the principal constituency of the CIA, what is the relationship here?
Principal constituent.
Is constituent the one who you work for? That's your constituent?
No.
Theoretically.
Okay, theoretically.
What
right.
Do you know about?
Okay.
That's correct.
I
you correct.
Okay.
It may well have been the sons of CFR members or CIA officials.
Somehow who had ransacked this office and pulled the CIA information out that let people then know something about the CIA and the public. Now, another thing. If, this is when we were doing this down in D.C., why ask the CIA to investigate the CIA?
That's
a stupid question I want to ask. I have a stupid question, but I'm stupid. Second question. Why not have a people's tribunal and take testimony from primary sources? Watch carefully who comes out and gets the focus.
In other words, if the young black children in our neighborhood process the crack cocaine, then why not go to them and ask them who the hump these were that dealt with them? They know. They got the answer. Ain't nobody even asked them.
I'm sorry, Bobby. They all up in my face. Boy, I'm ugly, man.
So why ain't nobody asked them? Why did they walk right past them and went right back to the white guy to ask him when the boy's right out?
I see him right on the other corner. I went out there tonight and asked him, say, hey, bro. Look, if you had the opportunity to tell on some hunkies that put that power up in the neighborhood, would you do it? Said, man, if I could get out of this syndrome, I'd tell on them in a minute. Ain't nobody asked me. Not him talking all that CIA drug stuff, ain't nobody asked me. I deal with them. They come right here. We exchange money, big money. We come to each other. We got attorneys. They got people get us out of jail. White lawyers who get them out of jail. Who know how to go down there and get put them in another category or a bracket. So when they go up before the judge, they in a lower bracket. They know. And nobody asked them. I'm a little worried if nobody asked, you know. I'm a little worried about when we had our own tribunal, had our own trial. Now, one of the ways that you can fight it, somebody steps up and says, yeah, you did this thing with Blandone and Richard Ross. Well, you want to address the CIA on selling drugs. One of the first things you must do is you must go and establish in the past. Please turn the lights down. Establish when they sold drugs. See, my mind is ahead of my body here. In the past. Okay? All right, fourth case, I don't know if my stuff right, it's called a promo facie. Promo facie, the legal term means on the surface. It appears to be true. Establish when they sold drugs in the past. Set the promo facie. On the surface, it appears to be true. So when I look at the news people doing the CIA story, and they're repudiating the allegations of the blacks, they say profound statements like, we never sold drugs at any time ever. But damn, my brother was in Vietnam, he saw some shit. You know, he saw that shit. Korea, soldier man saw shit, he knows he's seen the shit. Brothers working in the Caribbean, Panama, Latin America, they saw shit. They know the shit came in with heroin. So you would have to go to places where CIA sold drugs in the past. So then we would take evidence from an ex-CIA officer, John Stockwell, white boy, good white source. John Stockwell wrote one book, Praetorian Guard. He wrote several books, In Search of Enemies, bunch of books on the CIA. Good, honest writer. He was, in fact, he worked in Africa. As a matter of fact, he was stationed in Africa gave good information on the murder of Lumumba and others. So he tells a little history on the involvement of CIA and drugs in the past. The drug war, a closer look. I would offer this chapter a testimony. Now, to back up the validity of the testimony, we would have to send another group out to get John Stockwell, to get Terry Reed, who wrote the other book, and ask them to be prepared to come and testify before the black people to affirm the statement made in your book. But I'm only laying the book as a promo facing of what we will find when we bring them in. And you're going to give me the subpoena power to go get them. Okay? Oh, no, we don't want that. Do we don't want that? Or do we want that? We want to go get these people? Do we go get these people and bring them in and let them attest to the things in that book? Huh? No, I don't think Terry Reed, who had a hard time with other white people, tried to kill him off. Him and his wife tried to kill him off. Not to tell the story about how he trained to fly his pilots in Mena, Arkansas. But when it came out with the investigation of Mena, the one everybody's waiting for to tell them what happened with the CIA, just completed an investigation. Don't nobody even know what he did. John Hitz. Anybody know? Well, you know who John Hitz is. You might know. People who come to my regular. Anybody know who John Hitz is? H-I-T-Z.
Frederick.
Huh?
Frederick.
Yeah. You know who he is?
Yeah.
Who's that?
He's the
Inspector
General for the CIA.
And if you heard Maxine Waters just the other day on the radio, she said the primary, we're waiting on the primary investigation, which is being conducted by the CIA Inspector General, Frederick Hitz. Now, what is Frederick Hitz's history on investigating this? Because it may be so bad, we don't even want to wait for him. I mean, if I could, you know how some expert witness is coming in, and someone come in, said, well, you know, he's just a whole cold sucker, prostitute user. So this is the counselor to the president. I'm telling you, he's a cold sucker, prostitute user. Mm-hmm. So if you impugn his character, he's going to have to leave his job. So who will impugn his character? So now other things that he says have less weight, yes?
Yes.
So John Gibbs is a target of someone who needs to be. If we want to do the story right, we got to start rolling blocking the people coming down to block a guardian animal for the people who ordered this to be done. You understand what I'm saying? So John Hitz is a guardian animal, rolling blocker. And go look up where Brother Donald at. He gone? Well, Donald got that book with me on the FBI in Hoover. Look in there, you'll see John Hitz's daddy was the Justice Department attorney that inspired his son to be the CIA Inspector General. The Hitz got a whole history of doing anti-black things. Now, so they waiting on Hitz to come out and to do something, but Hitz just did an investigation of Mena, Arkansas, and said that absolutely nothing was going on in Mena, and in fact, they were there just 2 weeks training pilots. And I asked my friend, who done heard the CIA drug story, in fact, he's back there on the table, the point was, what pilot do you know who can't even speak English gonna come to America and in 2 weeks learn the language and fly a plane too? Said in 2 weeks, it took them 2 weeks to get the suckers to do 50 push-ups. Because they had this dude, Emilio Camp, who was a military advisor for the conference, who was sent up here to get these pilots into shape so that in case the plane crashed, they could fight. And of course, the same plane fell, and Eugene Hoffman walked out the plane and told that he was running drugs and guns. And I just left Milwaukee, Wisconsin, a half a year ago, was at the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee, and we drove up on the corner. Eugene Hoffman is a bum that sits on a park bench on the corner of the YMCA in Milwaukee. He's almost like a landmark that people drive by him and ridicule his life, have ruined his life for telling on Ali North and them. But God saved that one white boy's life to walk up out of that plane so that he could tell that they were running that. And that started the Iran-Contra investigation when Hoffman Wood's plane went down. Mm-hmm. White boy from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, you can call him in today, he'll testify for some bread. No, I'm telling you, he's been devastated. I saw the man. Lauren looked like a unibomber. who in fact was brought out by name Unibomber Man of the Year. I like the Unibomber. Man of the Year, Unibomber. And he was so powerful, you see the Washington Post now want to make him look weak and chivalrous and shit, make him look like he's psychotherapeutic and shit. Of course, a hunky living in the woods don't have running water and a damn toilet. You know there's something wrong with him coming up out of Harvard and that shit, but let's get a man a hand, kid. He knew how to fight the New World Order.
Okay.
And I appreciate the human problem. Anyway, what John Stockwell does in testifying before our grand jury is he identifies different times when the CIA, and he knows this because he worked in these, he had to read about the program to do what he was doing in Africa. And he mentions different code names that you should have as evidence so that when the CIA says, "What do you mean? I watched this guy Kessler go on CNN versus Maxine Waters." He says, "The CIA has all the money it can get. It doesn't need to sell drugs." And then you say, "Well, excuse me, sir, what about one, the Golden Triangle? Does that ring a bell to you?"
Yeah.
I even saw the triangle right.
No, that's right.
Okay, anyway. No, I mean, y'all kidding.
Sorry, sir.
Huh?
Sorry, sir.
All right, so you're right. I appreciate that. Okay, Golden Triangle. Which was in where? Y'all heard of that before? In Southeast Asia. Right? Go check Martin King. I got a tape back there of Mysterious Deaths in the New World Order. Martin King talks about America supporting the head of South Vietnam, Jim. A lot of drugs was moving off of the Vietnam War, North Vietnam, South Vietnam. Martin King made a point and said, "America has got us in a war fighting to help the South Vietnamese, and Jim's hero is Adolf Hitler. Got Hitler in his office, got Hitler in his wallet, got Hitler on his chest. How could America, with its moral decadence, support a man who is hero with Hitler?" You don't hear no anti-Semitism over that. And Martin raised the question. They killed him a year to the day. He raised the question. He raised the question April 4th, 67. They killed him April 4th, 68, just to be exact. And you get the tape back there called The Last Days of Martin King, looking at the role of Jesse James in the death of Martin King. That's Jesse Jackson and James Bevel. Both of them were informing on behalf of the FBI to get Martin King off the planet. In fact, we've been trying to get Jesse Jackson's FBI file, and all we come up with is a personnel number. You ask Jesse, you know, as long as you've been out, you ain't never been against, I've seen Al Sampson's file. Al Sampson was there. Walter Fauntroy was there. I've seen their files. I've seen the blotout. I've seen the format. I remember sitting at Savior's Day with Al Sampson when he had just got his file. Looking at the files, looking at the format, the style of how it was they were watching them. A lot of the stuff was newspaper clippings. Your local black paper serves the intelligence community by picturing people. And those pictures become a file at those agencies who have no other way of identifying you. Ebony focuses on emerging leadership. Those become files on them as Ebony fingers emerging blacks in their look who's up and coming column. Who's in the news? A black that gets a big job. Cut out 52 weeks of jet with blacks who got new jobs and see if you don't have an intelligence file on emerging upcoming blacks. You don't know intelligence when you see it in terms of how the agency uses keep the Afro-American in business, even though it can't make no money, giving it large full-paid ads with cigarette companies to poor Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, poor Lou Alcindor, who ran out of money and had to get with Kors. Because Kors was a fish bastard hunky who was a devious sex molester who paid for planes for Holly Norton them to sell them damn drugs. It was Kors who gave the planes that sold the drugs. Now, you in the issue, you really know the issue. Just a little sidebar, I ain't going to get into that. You check Holly Norton testifying about the planes that old boy Kors bought, who's a sixth-genic, who's the primary supporter of the Cato Institute, which is a right-wing think tank. So you got the Golden Triangle. You also got something called, you tell me where this is. Where's the Golden Triangle? Afghanistan. Yeah, now look at the two names, Triangle and Crescent. Did you notice that wife is even esoteric with the drug kit?
Oh, yeah.
Triangle, Crescent. That ain't no, arbitrary shit. That's esoteric shit.
Yeah.
They sell drugs under esoteric content. Caught him will probably understand. Where else? Where else they sell drugs? Now, it's funny to say CIA don't sell drugs. Look up the deal. Some of the movies, Clear and Fresh of Danger.
Right.
There they are, the CIA is deciding that they're going to allow the military to be killed so that they could empower another drug lord so that they could get better control off of property. Now, so then when they say you bring this shit up, you're paranoid. You could have just been to the movie. Say, I'm a Harrison Ford fan. And the guy who writes the book, Clear and Fresh of Danger and a little bit other one. And what is he known for? Is he known for writing dumb shit?
Yeah.
No, he's considered one of the highest intelligence novelists, and he'll tell you that some of his script is written by the CIA. Right. All of them will tell you that the government assists them with how the inside looks to add reliability to an outside motion they want supported by using the movie. Do you know CIA is in the movie business?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know movies about drugs. Again, I go back. I remember you hearing in my case, Counterintelligence 1986. I was looking at a front page story about my crack epidemic, and I had testimony from a young black, even down on WGON in Chicago, to say that crack was nowhere on the street in the black community. In Chicago, it was nowhere on the street, but they were calling it an epidemic. But they were, in fact, opening up for business. You see, you got to get into the buildup of crack as an entity that made someone go and ask for crack.
Right.
It was the CIA that used the CIA media to build up that there was a drug alternative. So it wasn't just that they assisted crack, but they used the media to blow crack up into an epidemic and create a demand. Now, what about, anybody ever heard of this? What's the other one? See how well we know it? Y'all heard of them?
Oh yeah.
Now, what is the U.S. government involvement with them? The U.S. government was supporting the heads of the Colombian government. Now, three sets of Colombian government to resign. Now, the drug dealers took on the judges, they killed like 80 judges, they knocked out a whole tier of people who were litigating against them, saying that, how dare you litigate against me, we already paid you off.
Right.
So they killed the ones who took money from them, who tried to prosecute or front them in the public. Now you need to be up on that, because this involves not only the Colombian government, but the American government, and it involves the primary maker of the paste. The primary maker of the paste that goes into cocaine is... That's right. You ever heard of that? Yes, sir. The plastic, the paste. He's a petroleum byproduct. You got to get into petroleum byproduct. You got to get into the role of oil in drugs. All of the cocaine boys down there will tell you that they use the profit from the cocaine to make a military that protected the oil field.
What did Dr. Hoffman say in the graduate? What did they tell him?
Get into plastic. Get into plastic. And that was at the time when oil went from $26 with Miss Robinson. $26 a gallon to up to $3-something with rationing. People dying in rationing lines.
Oh, yeah.
You old enough to remember that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Just to test to see if oil could be used in an emergency, in a state of emergency as a delineator of population. between how you separate or compartmentalize people. You make oil available in only certain places. Eventually, you will run out of oil if you have no other way to move around. That's why snow, bad weather, the inability of normal things to work are a context or an environment where we should get excited. It may be that young brothers could do it in a snowstorm. Because with only one or two ways to walk or move, it might be over by the time the weather clears. In fact, the weather ain't gonna clear until it's over. The storm's gonna start and ain't gonna stop till we finish. That's when you know. You're gonna look up to, damn, it's the eighth day of the storm. Now, Brother Coakley told me that the storm gonna start and ain't gonna stop till we finish. All of a sudden, you hear him running down the street. Come on, man! Come on out! Come on, man! Let's go over to the other side of town. We get the house. Always there. People will go when they got something to go for. And all of us with some of my earlier tapes, I used to go to these days, I say, look, how many of y'all in here want a new house? How many of y'all in here want a new house? Any y'all in here want a new house? Anybody? Yeah. What's a nice neighborhood in Baltimore?
Guilford.
Yeah.
Guilford?
Yeah,
I couldn't get it out.
Is that real? Guilford?
Guilford.
And first. But why don't you drive around Guilford and look at a house? You know? I mean, just look out and say, now that's the house. I like that house. And all you gotta do is go stand in front of the house with your name, the number, register with Brother Donald. It's the house I want when the kid comes. And then, oh, listen, I'm telling you, what do you think people gonna fight for? Why are people ready to fight? Because they don't know what they will win. That's why I know these niggas ain't for no revolution, because they ain't ever impregnated people with the hope of winning. In the tape Revolution 101, and I don't even have none with me, I tell the people, go out and inventory what is reality. Imagine the Baltimore Airport, the Baltimore Port, the harbor, all the stores down there, the ballpark, the parking lot, the street signs, the stop signs, the schools, the libraries. That's what you get when you win. You get all of that. But unless people have a faith to fight, there ain't no fight. So watch how people fight the dream of winning. Know what I mean? I'm telling you, if you went around and start passing out shit registered for a house, people gonna come out and condemn you. When we came out with economic sanctions, a black African sister in D.C. came out against us by saying that if you had sanctions against whites, they're gonna fire all the blacks that work for them. Put it right in the news in a minute. No, do not support economic sanctions. When he was out here waving sanctions up here at the Korean store, what did the damn news do? Stop, took a whole day, used all the news to go out there and interview the people to have them repudiate economic sanctions. They said, well, we're not here for that. And they say, well, look, that shit might spread, shut, close that fucking store and shut them down. Because if they stop fucking with that other shit, then we're all going to be in trouble. Okay. This just going to have to be a goat we're going to sacrifice. To the devil, we sacrifice many goats. Scapegoats. This went on since then. And you know, all the Korean kept saying is, you all do this. Y'all know y'all buy the same shit we buy. So he's saying, hey, why us? We paid already. Yeah, you need to find the Koreans' lawyer, because that's the lawyer. See, in Chicago, we stepped up. When the Koreans, the Greeks, they got like a Papa Saw, Mama Saw type of thing. Everybody come to town, you buy from him. The warehouse, where they all get their shit from the same person. And they better get it, because they got mafia. They got Korean mafia that kick their ass if they don't buy from the right person. You know what I'm telling you? You think they just out there running free. They locked into some other shit that they never want to tell you about. And they got godfathers, and you gotta find out who the godfather is for them, because that's the one you watch. That's the one you watch. And the Greeks got them, the Italians got them, the Mexicans got them. You look at the Mexicans all innocent, some of the strongest heroin sellers are walking by you looking all sloppy with pounds and shit all up under their shirt. You see them all look drunk and shit, and they deep on heroin. I worked in them jails and saw, look at them Mexicans, them Herrera boys, they look so now look so gumpy, look so stupid looking, work millions and millions of dollars owning government.
Oh yeah.
Sitting up there waiting 2-3 years till they get out. All them Cali boys went to jail, the worst one only got 10 years. They said, yeah, they gonna let us out of here. Anyway, so you need to know where else that they sell drugs, so that you can lay the formal facing that it is possible that they could have sold drugs in South Central because they had what? The Golden Triangle, what's that? The Golden Frame or the Golden Crescent?
French Connection.
And the French Connection, Bobby. That was the next one, the French Connection. Y'all remember the movie?
Oh, yeah.
Y'all know who was the French Connection? That was the French intelligence, the American intelligence, and the mafia. Y'all thinking about Gene Hackman and shit. I remember when that was out, that was the biggest movie of the day. The French is hot. Academy Award and shit for Popeye.
Oh, yeah.
So he popped out Doyle, that's right. How is movie going? French Connection. That's CIA mafia. Hey, let's take mafia, mafia. Did the mafia ever work with the CIA? So the mafia say, look, okay, CIA, you want us to go kill that nigga in the Congo. We'll kill the nigga in the Congo, but you gotta let us move some drugs. And CIA say, well, look, you can move the drugs, just give us 10% of the case. So they had this relationship. Let's take testimony from Sam Giancana. Sam Giancana, his brother, wrote a book called Double Cross. Huh? Hey man, how they own Kennedy?
Right.
There's a look. I'm getting ready to go to the next part of the entitled Homosexuality versus Promiscuity. It was the promiscuity of John and Robert Kennedy. Robert Kennedy and John Kennedy both slept with Marilyn Monroe. In fact, did you see that big Dark Sliders or something? Aretha throw a rope where they blazed that shit across, huh? Dark Sky. Yeah, that was some heavy. As we had just talked about, sent a tape back there called Homosexuality versus Promiscuity. How Martin King ended up getting sacrificed for the promiscuity of the Kennedy boys, who knew Hoover was homosexual but didn't choose to bust him. But Hoover busted him still for their promiscuity.
Right.
So Hoover looks up and Kennedy just slept with the secretary, with the press secretary of Jackie Kennedy. So Hoover got the picture. So Kennedy's in a scandal, he go to Britain, he go to this prostitute ring. The prostitute ring is made up of Soviet spy women who are bedding British and American men to get their information. The Secretary of Defense in Britain under Harold McMillan is going down in a scandal for sleeping with the women. Kennedy's ordering all the cables sent to him about the story because he slept with the same women. Hoover flies over there, gets the pictures, leaks a story in Europe that Kennedy slept with the woman, that high U.S. officials slept in the Caldwell ring that brought down Secretary Pomeroy or some shit. All of a sudden, Robert goes to Edgar, who put the story in there, and begged him to kill the story. And Hoover said, well, you know, I need an executive order to get another term because I'm over retirement age. So if you can announce tomorrow that I'm being reinstated, that will assist you. You know where Hoover was when John Kennedy got shot? You know where he was? Right across the street. At the racetrack.
Behind
him. Right here on the telephone. No, Nixon was in doubt. Nixon was in doubt. Hoover was right here at the racetrack, dressed in a black shirt, white face bra, and one of them little women hats with the little thing come over your face with the little hole in it. A veil. Because Hoover was gay Edgar Hoover. His girlfriend was Roy Korn, the attorney. I asked him to get the book from me, the Roy Korn book. Because Roy Korn is the little Jewish attorney who was a high-powered Jewish attorney bitch. I took the pledge at the Million Man March never to call a woman a bitch. And as I call these men's names, you know what I'm calling out. Because I want you to understand what it meant for Hoover to see John Kennedy killed, Robert Kennedy killed, Malcolm X killed, and Martin King killed. The only way all that killing could come down is that the bitch in you, Hoover. See, if a man running something, and then there's this bitch in Hoover trying to run something. Hoover's taking the Metro liner up to Washington with the top suite in the Park Sheridan where Myra Lansky and put the little cameras in there. You pictures of Hoover playing games with blonde-haired white boys who he may wear leather contact gloves while they touch the gentleman. Hoover, Clyde Folsom, was his girlfriend, boyfriend, deputy FBI.
40 years.
For 40 years. Then he thought Clyde was getting old, so he started taking the train up to New York having young boys to raise coins. It's in this book over here.
Platon was
Ford Motor Company.
McCarthy.
Huh? McCarthy, right, in the McCarthy name. And that's where all the parties met up. John Kennedy as the senator, Robert Kennedy as the investigator. On the, and this is the book Official cover, I'm sure Brother Donald will be able to get you some more. He's official and confidential, the secret life of Gans of Hoover. Hoover used to go right over here where Myra Lassiter used to fix racist for him. Hoover set up in the box dressed as a woman. There's a lady in here of the husband of Louis Rosenthal who said, I married Rosenthal, found out he was gay, and they used to make me come and watch the sex acts of Hoover and all Ray Coyne and all that. And remember the movie JFK? Remember the movie JFK with David Ferry and Clay Shaw all dressed in Roman clothes, doing it to each other before they go out and murder the president? Homosexuality versus promiscuity. Remember that, because you got to understand how when Robert Kennedy kept resisting, giving Hoover the permission to wiretap Martin King, finally when Hoover said, well, look, buddy, you was with Marilyn Monroe the night she died. Here's a picture of you taking her body back in her house after you took her in the ambulance to the hospital and she died on the way. Now, you and your brother slept with her. Now, what you want me to do? He said, I need a wiretap on Martin King. And Robert Kennedy said, I only gave him the permission for one, but the wiretap never stopped till the day he died. He even stayed on after he died. So how did Kennedy lose control of Hoover? They had to give up Martin King because they promised you it. And that goes right back into our leadership. That goes right back into whether we're going to be effective or not on how our pathologies get manipulated in the public. In the real world, they don't care what you do if they got the information on what you do. Because they'll know, they're in the exposing you, they're in the controlling you. And if jail is the last thing, if you ain't gonna take all the warnings, then they go to jail. Or they go shoot you up with the needle, make you say you did the needle. Or whatever else they use. All the things, the mechanisms, as they work down to get control of another person. Homosexuality versus promiscuity. We need to be up on that.
Like Colby.
William Colby. And you know who the first witness was against O.J. was William Colby's son and his ex-wife, who lived next door to Nicole Brown. It was the Colby who said they saw O.J. peeping through the window. The Colby said they saw O.J. peeping through the window, watching as O.J. said he saw her in sex.
Yeah.
Colby lived next door. Next thing you know, a great swimmer is found dead in Rock Creek Point or whatever. Yeah, Rock Point. Rock Point. Yeah, anyway, I don't know what that means. You might not even be there. Anyway, so as we begin to go back into what it is that the CIA does, oh, let me do, I got to do a Giancana. I'm going to hold Giancana until the radio is going to come on the minute. Let me show you these things before it comes on. Base theory on evil. So we've gone through the where CIA sells drugs in the past, who the principal constituency is, the unreliability of how we started our strategy to get at the CIA drug story by going back to the CIA to ask for the answers when we could ask the principal players in the game, ourselves. And also, I got a case that I want to play you. And this case is Tyrone Power talking about Ricky Ross. It was on WOL maybe last Monday or so. This is very important because as I was reading Tyrone Power's book, I noticed him say he was in Cincinnati in 87. Now, this is what happens when we read stories. This is why we're dangerous. In our black intelligence agency, our inferred knowledge is very good. Our intuitive knowledge is very good, meaning you can look at two things and go, boom, and flush some other stuff out. We did a good job in asking about something that was in the book that said his greatest drug capability was in an area called Lincoln Heights, and right outside of Cincinnati, Ohio. And he talked about going to Cincinnati and getting an argument with a supervisor and other things. Well, I had an interesting conversation with Tony Martin, who published the book, and my concept was that I expected more from Tyrone Powers on issues that he should have knowledge of, and that our judgment as to how effective he was going to be as a brother was going to be based on how honest he was about his relationships with the FBI and those relationships impacting on the black community. So we look at the thieves in Cincinnati in 87, look at the Ricky Ross story that says it got so hot in L.A. that he went to Cincinnati to cool out. He said, I got to Cincinnati and saw that Kilo, which was selling for $12,000 in L.A., I sold it for $50,000 in Cincinnati. I said, oh, shit, I got to get back in the business. So he gets back in the business. But you know, that ain't in here. ain't any of them. Ain't no reason for all. It ain't no, I tried to arrest them and they wouldn't let me. That ain't it, but that's very significant. Because if you're talking about the impact of the drug trade and the CIA, what if Tyrone Power says, well, you know, said, well, you know, listen, somebody want to see you over there. Very loudly. Now, so, it would be important to know why we jamming the CIA for what they did. What if the FBI tried to arrest Ricky Ross and the FBI wouldn't let him? What if that was so? What if he said, look, I tried to buy from Ricky Ross, but he kept sending other people to me. So one, whoever Ricky Ross was. And the second point was, so when you know, did the call come yet? They call. They're supposed to call in, they'll call from the radio station itself. We'll hear that. In fact, that light was so, will the phone ring, will the phone ring in the speaker? Huh? You got it all. Like a perpetrator. I got this thing where I don't really care.
You can
be my best friend. I only be in the high turnout. Are we off again? Hey, Bob, we were on live. That was the station. Did you hear it? You know what I mean? You ain't got the phone plugged into the radio, do you? Yeah, you cut it off. Where's that? The speaker off. Maybe is that the local station here? Okay, thank you, Bob. I take all that conspiracy back. You just a simple perpetrator. Thank you, Bob. I jump back into the line of things. I'm not too good at staying in line. All right, thank you, Bob. So it would be important to know if the FBI wouldn't let him arrest Ricky Ross, because that would have an impact on the FBI and CIA's relationship. If 87 and 88 he couldn't do it, and Ricky Ross don't get taken down till 94, then we're talking about time past where things could have been done that weren't done that allowed Ricky Ross to get back to Blandone in San Diego, where he did this one last trick for Blandone. In fact, it shows that the feds were planning to get Ricky Ross while he was in jail. So when we let him off, Blandone, we let him out, we're going to ask you to set him up. He was still in jail when they did that. But remember, Ricky Ross told on some police. Some of the same police he had worked with. Now we get this relationship where we start picking up sparks off of people who are double and triple dealing each other. Somebody sleep with the police one day and pay them, and then tell on them the next day. The police sleep with them one day and got to try to kill them the next day. And then we getting caught in all these triple and fourfold under dealings on each other. Well, they're all riding the low road. I mean, ain't none of them going to be of any value to us. Other than now, telling on each other. Which we accept all telling, but we got our own fact-finding score. Anyway, so let me go back to Bayes' theory on evil. If the CIA is served, we remember the role of life. We remember the role of the founding of things. That this is the society whose cornerstone is masonry. In the tape in the back, you will want to take the serious depth of New World Order. It alleges that blacks don't have an Afrocentric theory on New World Order. We tend to repeat white theory. We're into Epperson, we're into Cooper, but we ain't gonna get into Copeland. Copeland says the biggest crime of New World Order is colonialism. The second biggest crime is the murders that were necessary to take the land. Murder is a crime with no statute of limitations. If you're going to be against the New World Order, be into hunting the victims of the New World Order. Being in the New World Order is not a crime. But to have killed Malcolm X and Martin King to achieve the New World Order, now that's a crime. And in the power of hunting the crime, you get strength and authority. Authority. We need authority over things. Our authority arrives from the hunt. I'm telling you now, this is when you know niggas is faking when they ain't hunting shit. You got to hunt this shit down, and when you catch it, you must kill it. But you must hunt it down. You're in pursuit of something. The answer nor the victory will deliver is coming by FedEx. The cornerstone of the society is the secret society of Masons and them boys, but them 72 squares, are what I stand on, because them 72 squares, as Manly Palmer talked about, have something to do with something called the tetragrammaton, or the unspoken name of God. It's very important. The 72 combinations that are on that dollar bill, very important, because the unspoken name of God is going to show up under many different contexts. You say, well, why get into that? Because, again, if we go down to Center Street and Light Street and see the George Washington statue with Lafayette right across from it, if we go to the George Washington Masonic Memorial in Alexandria, we see Lafayette's apron that he gave to George Washington with the skull and crossbones on it. So, but we see that down in Washington in Light Center Street. Yeah, and by the way, do you hear Chapel Hughes openly advocating the merger of B, G, and E, and Pepco, saying that they hire in the community? Do you know that Pepco pleaded guilty in a racial discrimination case and had to put $180 million in trust? Some of my friends applied and got money out of the claim because Pepco was the most racist hiring institution in Washington.
That's right.
And my friends who work on Pepco have told me that the whites and BG&E are knocking out the blacks in Pepco. And for example, he's getting bumped $15,000 as a result of the merger. So Kathy, while you fatten up your ass on the stock of Pepco, just remember the black people who you sold out, who could get electricity from a black person who has it in Memphis and wouldn't have to take it from the monopoly of BGE and Pepco if you just got up out of the asshole and let the people get the electricity on a competitive market. You're trying to sell some bum shit to the people by playing it up like it'll be like the phone thing. You don't want no old boy out of West Virginia coming up here. I don't want no hunky out of Baltimore up here. There's no black utilities in the world. So why not compel them to give up territory as part of the merger agreement and quit kissing ass? Just a little sidebar. House of the Mother Supreme down in Washington, where Albert Pike and all of the berries. We went down there last Sunday. Y'all know anything about that merger? Y'all for that? Y'all heard us stand up and have to run that thing 15 times a day. Yeah, run it 15 times a day advocating the merger between, and you don't even, who's the chairman of BG&E? Who's the chairman of Pepco? Who's going to name these five directors of BG&E? Name me the bank that has the most stock in BG&E. Name me the chairman of Pepco. Name me five people on Pepco. Captain, you cannot compel black people to agree to something they do not understand. That's malicious. Educate them about what it is. Then offer them that option and let them decide. But don't ramrod no shit on no black people. Your ass ain't working. And you got stock in the damn thing. Tell the people the truth. Next time you call in, ask if somebody at the radio station got stock in Pepco. Yeah, that's the answer. Yeah, come help me get paid.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, all right. Anyway, I'm here. Anyway. Washington Monument, 555 feet tall. That's a symbol. That's 555. What's 5 plus 5 plus 5? So then you look to the carriage deck, the 15 carbon carriage deck.
Uh-oh.
Is the devil. So look, they have a thing called the, they have a thing in Washington called the Monument. The Monument Height Act of 1910, that says no building in Washington can be taller than the Washington Monument. It's legislated. But the symbol of the 555 is the beast. And nothing can be taller than the beast. That's why a year ago, Brother Hamzo and I, before he transgressed and kissed butt, gave a lecture together against Satan. But Hansel, he felt he transgressed against the family. We were putting out flyers with Captain Hughes as a witch. He put out all kind of flyers supporting me for being banned on WL. And I looked up here on WL saying, "See, Miles, before you got here, I was one who had transgressed against the family. But I have made amends for my transgression, for my part in the transgression. And I am, and because of my transgression, I was denied access to the radio." And you want to hear that?
Yeah.
I had it teed up on Brother Donald. I asked him to see Miles about the bootleg. Hey, anything on the radio?
You want to hear that too?
Okay, I'm going to play that too. Ain't nothing happened?
That's when they call him the special purpose.
Right, that's when they call him the special purpose.
When he's coming out of bars, they recognize God. I remember seeing him.
Huh? Yeah. What's up? Phone not ringing? Okay.
Praise be to Allah. For the sake of the spirit, I do say.
And thank you for your call. You don't see now. I said, here's the winner. Let's make a deal. You're number one. He really do. Seeing you on this New Year's Eve. He's one of the things that messed up the last week in front, you know. I appreciated the day he was fighting the ADL and the American Jewish Congress for not being involved in various things. Yeah. And it was going fine until Hamilton called and said, "Well, Farrakhan, you with them anyway." And that blew the whole against these whites. Then that blew the issue up and made it black against black. We lost the motion.
Okay.
Sometimes a fact is not good when you're against a greater enemy. When we're all against the whites, we sit against the whites. You don't beat the blacks while you're beating the whites.
Right.
And then that broke the motion down. And we lost.
They don't call you that.
Right. He said, "Oh, yeah, y'all got your lady." Said, "Well, why y'all making a mystery?" It was in the final call, which it was. But by that time, Steve Miles got confused. And he said, "Man, I don't even know what I'm doing now." And then it blew the edge. And sometimes we got to know. That's why I'll be against that religious zealot activism stuff. Because it gets us in trouble. But that's a whole nother thing. We'll deal with that.
November, December, give you the acronym of
envy or something.
Transliteration by removing your vowel form.
Like, he figured it out today, Hamilton figured out that, what was that whites were doing something against us?
The Moors.
He figured out that the United Nations was the place to subjugate the Moors. Well, when Rockefeller handed the $58 million check over to the head of the United Nations to build the building, he said it right there, fuck the niggas. He said it right there when he handed them the $58 million check. So we need to decodify all the rules to know that this kid was against us. Even though they got a black man out front now, to make it look like it's something better than
the movement of the sun symbolically.
I love the man. Really, I do.
And its movements through the heavens, but particularly within the context of the Masonic ritual and within the underworld. And what we're asking now being a first
way
point between the January the
6th.
Right.
Now y'all know the client's supposed to be lined up in 6 points
now. Because we went to the West and all that.
Now, he's asking him to explain what's on the flyer. Now this is our light. See, cut the light down. See this flyer? This is the flyer that he and I did a year ago in the lecture called Satan's Door to America. So each one of us put these numbers on. I mean, different things belong to him. He put this on there. He put that on there. That's his. This is mine. The 9 squares. We're going to talk about that. This is his. This is his. This is mine. This is his. This is mine. That's my Grecian sphinx. That's his. So we put this thing together. Now, he still uses this flyer as his format flyer. So see, now I put this on here. This is Captain Hughes. Now, when Captain Hughes saw me put this in front of her station on 4 minutes, she went on the air. Then Steve Coley out there putting me up. Tell him I drive a Cadillac, not a broomstick, will you? And she said, "Now this is really clever. In fact, I have the whole flyer." She laughed, but she said, "He's a sucker perpetrator. He's banned for life from WL." This was the flyer right here. I had Negro in the month.
Oh, yeah.
Armstrong Williams and Captain Hughes for advancing white supremacy within the black community by producing divisive Eurocentric radio programming. Because Armstrong Williams was starting a lot of trouble. Eventually, she figured out who he was. But while she was defending him against me, she had to let him go. But she could never come back and say, "You know, he was bad like you say he was. You know, after that strong sermon, but he took her to meet Oprah. So he just heard her meet Oprah, and she was got loose dress, and she was talking about the old big thing she loved. And y'all remember that about a year and a half ago? I'm strong and going all night weekend. That's the home number. Yeah, he's going to call, he's supposed to call from his mother's house. Maybe you can call his number and leave a message on his line. Well, he's got this number. There's no way it can't work. No way it can't work. Anyway, so we put out Negro of the Month. That was Armstrong Williams right there. You see Armstrong Williams laying on the end? That's Armstrong Williams right there. I drew him on there. And that's Captain Hughes on the broomstick.
Right.
So now, C. Miles was asking Hansel, well, what's the bundle of sticks? And what's the broomstick and the witch? So this is his answer. He says the witch is the daughter of the Confederacy. Now he didn't put it on the out there. He knows that the witch is who the witch is. But once you're getting back in, you agree not to say this no more. Now it's my man, that's my brother. And then he says, I made a man for my part in the translation. Meaning, who is the other circle perpetrator still out there ain't made amends for transgressing?
Right.
In fact, the tape with this on it is actually like called Transgressing Equal Confession. And that's, it's got a bunch of stuff on it, but you want that tape after January 7th, on January 14th. Let's see, I think Top Powers is in that one too. Or is Top Powers in the January 14th one? Yeah, Top Powers is in the January 14th one, Homosexuality versus Promiscuity. Okay, here's Hansel giving his version of what
you're always shown with witches.
Right.
Witches always ride broomsticks and carry brooms.
Right. And the women are always going to go get the broomstick of the witch, witch of the west and all that.
Well, see, the broomstick essentially symbolizes fascism.
That's what that is right there on the
head. And fascism is a bundle of sticks.
I like that.
That are bound together like this. The logo for the Rothschild family is five owls that are joined together by one hand, representing five sons.
You know what I'm saying? What's
that? So you need a bundle of sticks, you take a single stick, right?
Right.
And you can break it easily.
Right.
But if you broke that single stick into
eight, that's my story, too.
Combine all eight and try to break all eight.
That's the story that you had to massage here for about 5 months.
Forever man till the revolution comes.
But he's made amends for his transgression, and because of his transgression, he was denied access to the radio. Did you hear him on the radio? You see what making amends does? And you know he's making money. Now, I just beat eviction last Wednesday to pay my rent from January. From I wouldn't want to call it let down, maliciously misled by a black who got you going to a place for a lecture and then they cancel it right before it. Then they cancel the next one, they cancel the next one. You look up, you ain't going nowhere. And et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, or whatever. But so someone said, well, you know, bruh, you go down there and kiss that ass, you get on that radio. Now, you remember when you was on the radio, you had 1,000 people a night on the Tuesday night, making $6,000 to $7,000 a night with the radio. All you got to do to get that radio is to bite that button. Now, the day y'all hear my ass on the radio, y'all come. Yeah. But you can see what's wrong in Baltimore and Washington. It's what has made nothing out here. Is because the devil has set it up with, you ain't with the devil, you ain't with nothing. You'll get nothing. That's why I say, something, man, don't go to the Copley, that because Sanchez is on Copley, because he ain't in the fold, he's not cooperating. He's fucking jacking people up, bringing them in. He's fucking with them with what he said. I ain't gonna come running though, but he's all that old conspiracy with the Boule and all that bullshit. If we wasn't putting heat on them niggas, they would have had y'all ass in the camp a week ago. We got flanked by a bunch of niggas on the jet in every single city. You know, in every single city in America, the Africans know about the Boule, and it went across the country with no publicity. It was not in Ebony. It was not in Jet. It wasn't even in the Afro-American, but every community know it so. Now, why would I need to get on that when we got this? Why would I need to get on that when we got direct line? That's why we're going to start doing it every month. We're like direct line. We don't need nobody in the room. I don't need no radio to make, well, I'm going to hook y'all up in Cincinnati at the same time. Yeah, we ain't on no radio. But then this is the whole country we're dealing with. We ain't dealing with Baltimore and Washington. At the end, we will all come to Washington and do damage. Because somewhere in the diamond of D.C. is some key, some clue to the whereabouts of the biggest, strongest, whatever it is that wipes this butt to. It's somewhere locked into the diamond of D.C. life. It's locked somewhere into the diamond of D.C., which is why we work hard on it. That's why Mr. Farrakhan, he did it when he came to the Million Man March, he went to. He stopped calling it out. Now, you hit a white boy on, I got it on tape too. You hit a white boy on last week who was throwing down the hood of Holden, maybe. Yeah. Holden wants to get in on some black shit. So he said, look, man, when this dude who's running that quick when he's staying in Egypt,
right.
He's got all the key secrets, but he actually works in Boston University. And he's got all the key shit now. But then when Farrakhan get in trouble with the Million Man March and they can't account for the population, who's the man that comes and rescues the minister? The man in Boston who's got the keys to the pyramids in Egypt.
He's one of the sons of Hawks.
Oh yes, Bobby, some heavy shit. So the white boy Holman says, look, Dick, you gotta get me in on that. Because now you know the minister got some hookup with some shit and the stars and some other stuff dealing on his thing. And the white boy, the white who got information are coming to black for vessel because white won't take them. You become a hotbed for white. You have lived, you made Cooper live in a mansion. You got Epperson living well. I'm just barely making my rent. And my shit is far more profound than they'll ever come to you with. There ain't no death of Malcolm and Martin in Cale Horton. Ain't no anti-colonialism in Epperson Broca. Taking a nigga's land is all right for Epperson. Demonizing Kimmy is all right for all them books. And everybody promote them and hold them up every on WWL tomorrow. We got deeper keys on the CIA thing than they own, but that's all right, us laying off of the cover, letting them ride the way they ride, because when they get through, then that's what we show. I didn't do no radio show in the whole country on the CIA thing. I've been holding it. Now, on February 1st, I got a major address, and I don't even want to say the city, but the southern city, where the whole community of these cities are coming together for a big CIA drug thing. You're going to kick on pop in the news, because I didn't call them, but they called them. and this is going to be big. And I'm the main speaker, and I'm going to drop some key bombs on the CIA drug story that ain't come out or nothing. And when you drop, everybody will go. Everybody gonna want to duck, but look, I got an Afro-American coming at CIA hearing. Coming, y'all man, coming, coming. Well, look at the story. Coming at CIA hearing. It was like Cummings was a bad motherfucker because he was at the hearing. He didn't do shit, and he didn't say shit.